Mulwenny viewers, welcome to today's episode of Load Shedding, a show that focuses specifically on current affairs pertaining to the African continent. Today we shall be focusing on the controversial figure that was Winnie Mandela. You see, when news broke of her passing, my friends started a discussion of whether she was a hero or a villain, and myself was included in this discussion as well, and therefore I decided to make a video on it. Stay tuned, my name is Kees Kiwinda. The Truth and Reconciliation Commission was set up in the post-apartheid era with Archbishop Desmond Tutu as its chairman. The motive behind this commission was to uncover truths of what happened to missing or dead people in the apartheid era, with its end goal being forgiveness and moving forward. Members of the apartheid regime that committed heinous crimes have, if not at least been forgiven, somewhat faded from memory. I'm talking about the likes of Harold Snyman, Ruben Marx, Dantje Siebert, Gideon Niewald and Johan Beneke, who were never charged for the murder of Steve Biko. There was Jeffrey Benzin, who admitted to torturing prisoners via electrocution and asphyxiation, but remained with the police force after the apartheid regime was toppled. There was Riaan Bellingen, who fatally shot Z.J. Konile, but currently owns a private security company in Johannesburg. And, you know, the list goes on. Nelson Mandela was the commander of Umkhonto we Sizwe, and he managed to evade the police for the longest time thanks to wearing many disguises when out in the public. And because of his disguises and managing to stay away or evade the police, he was labeled or dubbed the Black Pimpernel. Unfortunately, as the story goes, he was eventually arrested and held in incarceration, and it was during this time that it was his wife that stepped up to the frame and kept the flame of the opposition alive whilst he was held in captivity. The young and beautiful Winnie started campaigning tirelessly for the release of her husband and faced arrest and continuous harassment from the police at every step of the way. In 1977, she was even banished to the remote town of Brantford in the hope that people would forget about her and she would relinquish her conquest. It had the opposite effect. The world started to take note, and famous people such as Ted Kennedy and Richard Attenborough came to visit her in person and would bring journalists with them. In 1985, Winnie Mandela came back to Soweto in defiance of a government order banning her from the township. It was what happened after this move that people now started drawing a comparison between Winnie and Nelson, the same way as was done back in the US between Malcolm X and Martin Luther King. You know, Nelson Mandela has by now attained somewhat of a saintly position, whereas Winnie Mandela is often portrayed as a troublesome villain. And it was due to her affiliation with the Mandela United Football Club, which brought about a reign of terror upon the township upon her return. In defiance and retaliation of the massacre of the Gugulethu Seven, she gave a speech in which she said, "We have no guns. We have only stones, boxes of matches and petrol. Together, hand in hand with our boxes of matches and our necklaces, we shall liberate this country." As a result of her affiliation with the Mandela United Football Club, who also acted as her bodyguards, the police suspected Miss Madikizela Mandela of 30 serious crimes, but the Attorney General did not prosecute her because he deemed her untouchable. The most notable names of people that died being connected with Winnie Mandela are the 14-year-old Stompie Muketsi, by Mandela's former bodyguard Jerry Richardson. And later Jerry admitted that Stompie realized that Jerry was a police informant and that that was the reason he killed him. In 1992, she was accused of ordering the murder of Dr. Abu Bakr Asvat, a family friend and a prominent Soweto doctor who had examined Saipai at Mandela's house after Saipai had been abducted, but before he had been killed. Mandela's role in the Asvat killing was later probed as part of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission hearings in 1997. She was said to have paid the equivalent of $8,000 and supplied the firearm used in the killing, which took place on the 27th of January in 1989. In November 1988, 21-year-old Lolo Sono and his 19-year-old friend Siboniso Shabalala disappeared in Soweto. Sono's father said he saw his son in a kombi, which is a minibus, with Winnie Mandela, and that his son had been badly beaten. Sono and Shabalala's bodies were exhumed from paupers' graves in Soweto's Avalon Cemetery in 2013 by the National Prosecuting Authority's Missing People's Task Team, having been stabbed soon after their abductions. Former Soweto police officer Henk Heslinga alleged that former Minister of Safety Sidney Mufamadi instructed him to reopen an investigation into the death of Muketsi, as well as all other cases made against Winnie Mandela, for the sole purpose of charging Winnie with murder. In its final report, the TRC ruled that Ms. Madikizela Mandela was politically and morally accountable for the gross violations of human rights committed by the Mandela United Football Club. More uncomfortable proceedings followed in 2001 when she was charged with fraud and theft involving an elaborate bank loan scheme and nearly 1 million rands, a sum then equivalent of £75,000. Ms. Madikizela Mandela, who was president of the African National Congress Women's League when she was charged, was convicted and sentenced to 5 years in jail. This, however, was later overturned on an appeal. Say what you want about Winnie Mandela, but she was definitely no coward and she was never one to bite her tongue. She showed her unhappiness with Madiba accepting the Nobel Peace Prize together with Frederick Willem de Klerk. She also called Archbishop Desmond Tutu a cretin because of his views of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. She voiced critical commentary on both Thabo Mbeki and Jacob Zuma and would also show up late at political rallies. She supported Julius Malema and his call for repossessing white-owned farms, but she also condemned the xenophobic attacks, and these attacks ironically used necklacing as methods to get rid of people, you know, burn them alive. But most importantly, she was critical of her ex-husband because, in her view, he had fallen short in getting a good deal for the blacks in post-apartheid, saying basically that her ex's image was solely good for generating money for his foundation. At first I thought Winnie Mandela to be a murderous, villainous drunkard. But my girlfriend told me that perhaps my view on her was warped and that I should look into her as a her character a little bit deeper. And that I did, and I must say that I'm eating my words. I mean, yes, at some point Winnie Mandela promoted violence and she was also a blatant adulterer. She also admitted having made many mistakes, but let's not forget one thing. People were at war, and during war, there will be casualties. Doesn't matter if Winnie was guilty or not. The apartheid regime itself did crimes that were way worse, and yet people got off scot-free and still control the economy of South Africa today. Winnie Mandela, on the other hand, was found guilty and sentenced for her crimes. Where's the reconciliation in that? Let's not forget that had it not been for that prophetic day when Nelson Mandela saw Winnie Mandela standing at the bus stop, there wouldn't have been a situation of keeping the flame awake when he was put into jail and incarcerated, because there wouldn't have been a Winnie Mandela to keep that flame going, to keep the flame alive. There cannot be a Nelson without Winnie. It's impossible. And therefore, to me, she's a hero. Thank you, Winnie Mandela, for the sacrifices that you've made for your country to show the world what you can do, not only as a human being, but as a woman of strength. May your soul rest in strength.